Hi everyone, welcome back to the lecture series of Tribology and Terotechnology. I am Neha Joshi, Assistant Professor in Mechanical Engineering Department at LJ Institute of Engineering and Technology. Let us start our sixth chapter, that is Tribological Aspect of Rolling Motion and Gears. In previous session, we covered our fifth chapter, that is Elastohydrodynamic and Mixed Lubrication. In today's session, we will cover different topics like what is rolling element bearings, type of roller elements bearing, and load capacity of roller bearings, and tribology of rolling bearing. Now, first of all, what is rolling element bearing? Rolling element bearing is also known as a roller bearing, okay, which are similar to the bell ball bearing in that they are designed to carry a load while minimizing friction. However, roller bearing transmit load using cylindrical rolling elements rather than the balls to maintain the separation between the moving parts of the bearing. The rolling element bearing find the application like in auto industry, electric motors, power tools, machine tools, conveyor, aircraft ship, land vehicles, CAT, dental drills, etc. There are more than 20,000 varieties of rolling bearings based on the material, okay, for like steel, polymer, ceramic, okay, then the with and without cage, various type of cages are there, with or without cells, okay. So these bearings are often referred to as an anti-friction bearing and require relatively less lubricant than that of the sliding bearing. In normal lubricant condition, friction and wear in rolling element bearing are very low and the bearings have long operational life. However, in the absence of lubrication, tangential and contact stress increase significantly, both of which shorten the bearing life. Okay. Now, we will discuss about the different terminology of the rolling bearing. Generally, there are four main components of rolling bearing. First one is inner ring, second one is rolling element, third one is cage, and fourth one is outer ring. Okay. Now, what is inner ring? This is a smaller of the two bearing rings and gets its name from the position it holds. It has a groove on its outside diameter to form a path for the balls or rollers. The surface of this path is precision finished through extremely tight tolerance and it is honed to a very smooth mirror-like surface finish. The inner ring is mounted on the shaft and it is usually rotating element. Okay, now second one is outer ring. This is a larger of the two rings and like its counterpart, the inner ring, its name is derived from the position it holds. Conversely, there is a groove on its inside diameter to form a pathway for the rollers or balls. This surface also has the same high precision finish of the inner ring. The outer ring is normally placed in the housing and it is usually held stationary. Okay. Now, third element is the rolling elements. These are the rolling elements that separate the inner and outer ring and permit the bearing to rotate with a minimal friction. Rolling element can be either ball, cylindrical rollers, spherical rollers, stepper rollers, or oil in the case of general bearing. Okay, and the last component is the cage. The main purpose of cage is to separate the balls or rollers and maintaining an even and consistent spacing to accurately guide the balls in the path or race way during the rotation and to prevent the balls from the falling out. Cage may be of steel, brass, bronze or phenolic composition depending upon the type and application of the bearing. Okay, now we will discuss about the different types of rolling bearing. There are different types of rolling bearing. First one is cylindrical roller type, then ball type, and taper roller type, barrel roller, spherical type, and needle type. Now, ball bearing support a good amount of radial load and normal amount of axial load, provide normal accuracy and work very well under the high speed condition, while the product producing very low noise and friction. Okay, what is cylindrical bearing use? Cylindrical bearing support a very good amount of radial load but the work poorly under the axial load and provide good accuracy and work well under high speed condition while producing sufficiently low noise and good friction resistance. Okay, third type is taper type roller bearing. A taper bearing support a very good amount of radial load and axial load but only in one direction. With an axial load provide good accuracy and work normally under the high speed condition while the producing low noise and good friction resistance. Okay. Now next one is spherical bearing. Spherical bearing support a very good amount of radial load and a good amount of axial load provide a poor accuracy but work normally under a high speed condition while produce a sufficiently low noise and good friction resistance. And last type is needle type bearing. Needle bearings support a very good amount of radial and axial load, provide good accuracy and work well under the high speed condition while producing sufficient low noise and good friction resistance. Okay, now we will discuss about the load capacity of the roller bearing. For a given area, rolling element bearing can sustain a much larger load than that of a hydrodynamic, permanent magnet or active magnet bearing. The prime consideration in calculating bearing load is the magnitude and direction of the radial bearing load or loads. The radial bearing load is due to the weight of the component, such as a shafting, flywheel, sheaves, pulley, or due to the tension resulting from the belt or chain drive, tangential loading on the transmission device, or inertial loading due to the rotary or the outbalance of the motion. To estimate the load capacity of the rolling bearing, consider the diagram as you can see in the inner ring and the outer ring, and the number of rolling elements placed between the inner and outer ring have been shown. In such an arrangement, either the inner or outer ring rotates, and as a result, rolling elements rotate. Due to the rotation of rolling element, each rolling element is subjected to the radial load, zero to maximum load. In other words, even if there is a steady radial load, rolling elements are subjected to the fluctuating loading. Now, on exerting radial load on inner ring, all the load gets transferred to the rolling element, and finally the load gets assigned to the outer ring. The load on any rolling element depends on the angular position with respect to load line. For example, rolling element 1 is subjected to maximum load, rolling element 2 has a lesser load intensity as compared to rolling element 1, and the load on the rolling element 3 even lesser compared to the rolling element 1 and 2. If the clearance between the rolling element and the ring is almost zero, then the only 50% of the outer ring is subjected to load, while the remaining 50% of the outer ring remains unloaded. In the presence of clearance, load on each rolling element is increased as the load portion of the outer ring decreases. To quantify this, load angle psi that represent 50% of the angular extent of the load. So psi is given by the equation. Psi 1 is equal to cos inverse cd upon 2 delta r. Now what is cd? Cd is the diameter of clearance and delta r is the radial shift of the outer ring. From this expression, it can be inferred that when cd is 0, the load angle psi 1 is 90 degree. It is desirable to keep cd as small as possible. Under the load, each rolling element becomes elastically deformed, and the deflection of rolling element delta is given by the equation k w is equal to k into delta raised to n. When w is applied load, k is equal to proportionality constant, n is equal to 1.5 if we are using balls, and 1.11 if we are using rollers. So load on the any rolling element can be given by the equation w psi is equal to w maximum cos psi raised to n. Now, if psi is 0, then load will be maximum, as you can see here in the diagram. The total load Fr transmitted to the outer ring can be expressed by the equation Fr is equal to sigma, psi is equal to minus psi 1, psi is equal to plus psi 1, W psi, cos psi. The total load Fr on the rolling element is given by the equation Fr for the ball is equal to Z upon 4.37 into W maximum, and Fr for the roller, Z is equal to Fr for roller is given by the equation Z by 4.06 into W maximum, where Z is equal to number of rollers in roller bearing or number of balls in the ball bearing. Now W maximum is the maximum load on any rolling element, okay, and it can be inferred that for an applied load Fr. The dynamic load capacity can be estimated by the fatigue life of the bearing. This can be found using the Lundenberg and Palmgren approach, which is given as C raised to A into 10 raised to 6 is equal to P1 raised to A, L1 is equal to P2 raised to A, L2 is equal to P3 raised to A into L3. The exponent A is equal to 3 for ball bearing, while it is equal to 10 by 3 for the roller bearing. If P1 is greater than C, then the bearing life L1 will be less than 10 raised to 6 rotation. Now this equation is valid only for the reliability of 90%. Sometimes the L10 life is used to indicate probability of the failure is equal to 10%. For bearing operating at a constant speed may be more convenient to deal with the basing rating life of the operating hours. Okay, so bearing life in hours is given by the equation C by P raised to A, okay, into 10 raised to 5 divided by 60 speed. Okay, now we will discuss about the typology of rolling bearing. Now standardization bearing have very good surface finish and reflect applied load within the 3 to 10% of the dynamic load capacity. Okay, the bearing operates in an elasto-hydrodynamic lubricant lubrication state. Appropriate lubricant minimizes sliding between the rolling elements and ring, thereby minimizing the friction and wear. Okay, so in addition, the lubricant also protect the bearing from corrosion. Now, without lubricant, coefficient of friction will increase. However, excess lubricant is harmful as it increases the coefficient of friction. As a thumb rule, at least 50% of the free space should be without any lubricant. The lubricant with a different viscosity and boundary additives may provide different outcomes. Selection of lubricant often depends on the operating condition and the environment. Okay. Now, generally, grease is easily retained in the bearing housing, particularly where shafts are inclined or vertical. To reduce friction, metallic shop thicker grease of consistency 1, 2 or 3 are normally used for rolling bearing. Okay. Now, a superficial guideline on quantity of grease. 4 centralized supply of grease having consistency of 1 or 2 is provided using the following equation. Q is equal to 0.00004 D into B gram per hour. Now, where D, what is D? D is the bearing outside diameter in mm and B is the bearing width or height in the mm. Okay, it is important to note that the friction coefficient is proportional to the side of contact area between rolling element and rest ring. For example, ball bearing with a 4 or 3 points of contact exhibit greater friction than a bearing with a 2 points of contact. Okay, so calculation of friction in a loaded bearing between rolling elements in this way is complex phenomena. The elastic hysteresis, sliding lubricant sharing and mechanical contact of seals are the main contribution of friction in anti-friction bearing. Okay, the use of chrome steel is making the rolling element and ring is preferred as it has a minimum coefficient of friction. Okay, so elastic hysteresis in the rolling. Appropriate selection and mounting of the bearing maintains a low sliding speed between the rolling element and guiding surface of the cage. The lubricant sharing can be calculated by the equation tau is equal to eta into du by dz. Load dependent friction moment can be given as mp is equal to fp into d by 2, where f is equal to coefficient of friction, p is equal to resultant load, which is given by the equation under root fr square plus fs square, and d is equal to bore diameter. So this is what about the tribology of rolling bearing, okay, and rolling element bearing. Okay, so thank you all of you for watching this video.